I would note respectfully that I'm just looking for a secular, that what is paramount before the court in an action of this nature is the proper interpretation of the Constitution. And indeed, as held in before an attorney general, even if, assuming without better, even if the CJ had written such a letter, for me, with all respect, it's immaterial.
A secular.
The secular, written such a secular, it is immaterial for me. It is a construction of the words of the Constitution that matter. Before an attorney general even indicated that this Chief Justice, who had lent himself to the process, which was subsequently pronounced upon as unconstitutional by the court, could not have waived any right whatsoever. Because there's no such thing as extra law under the Constitution. And indeed, I look at the provisions, the words in Articles 117 and 118. At least all it says is that civil or criminal processes coming from any court or place out of Parliament shall not be served on or executed in relation to the Speaker or a member of the Clerk of Parliament while he is on his way to attend an act or returning from any proceedings of Parliament. In my respect, I do not see mandate in Article 117. I do not see mandate there. I do not see Tuesdays to Friday. I do not see all that must be understood clearly. Irrespective of that secular, in my respect, I, the attorney general, can, or any citizen of the land, having been voted for the Supreme Court, can serve the process on a member of parliament, the speaker of parliament, or a clerk to parliament, except when he's on his way to parliament or returning from parliament. That's what it says. But again, there is an attempt to suggest, and it was implied in the submissions relating to the Supreme Court overstepping its bounds and what have you, that Parliament of Ghana,
I don't have a right of reply, but it's down over 25 minutes. Yeah.
Attorney General, you have 1 minute.
But I don't have a right to reply, especially that he got up only on points of law. So but he's exceeding.
Maybe, yes, the point of law I made is because of application.
Please don't waste your 1 minute.
Madam President, maybe the point I'm making is that the Supreme Court's judicial review powers, pursuant to Articles 2 clause 1 and 130 clause 1, extend to any authority, institution of state, or any individual in the country. No arm of government, no institution of state, and definitely no individual is exempt from it. Indeed, the president himself is even subject to Supreme Court's judicial review powers under the Constitution. And the Constitution spells out the consequences for a failure to obey decisions and orders and directives of the Supreme Court. That is in Article 2, Clause 4. Failure to obey or carry out the terms of an order or direction made or given under Clause 2 of this article constitutes a high crime under this Constitution, and shall, in the case of the President or the Vice President, constitute a ground for removal from office under this Constitution. We shall declare the powers of the court can never be questioned at all. And it is for this reason that the Supreme Court, in Tufor and Attorney General, and further fortified by J.H. Mensah and Attorney General, reported in 1996 Supreme Court of Ghana Law Report, stated clearly that in Ghana, there's even no such thing as a political person. The court can call into question any act or omission of any person at all, insofar as it's in violation of the Constitution. So the contention by my left friend, counsel for fair defendants, that it was an administrative decision of the speaker. And so with all respect, I'll ask, and so what? Any administrative decision of a person or authority which comes in contravention of the Constitution is amenable to the court's judicial review powers. I strongly submit that the application before you is totally offensive to all rules and procedure of this honorable court, is unknown to the laws of Ghana, and must be dismissed. I pray accordingly.